faith matters. An interactive program brought to you by MTA International.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome to another edition of Faith Matters, where you, our viewers, set the agenda by the questions you ask. Jazakum Allah and thank you for the questions you've been sending in, but just as a reminder to viewers, for future questions or any thoughts, comments or observations, it's the email here in London is faithmatters@mta.tv. That's faithmatters@mta.tv. We have been asked previously about programs that have aired on Faith Matters and the subjects we've covered off. Well, I'm delighted to tell you, you can find these now on YouTube. Go to YouTube, put in the words MTA Online 1, the subject you're after, and hopefully you'll find the answer right there. And if not, you know what to do. Email us on faithmatters@mta.tv. We have previously given the fax number, but I'm delighted to tell viewers our technology is such that rarely have we found a fax coming our way. But for those who do wish to use the fax, one final time, I think we'll give it to you. It's 44 for the UK, 208-687-8037. It's the final time for the facts, but it's the first of the questions, and I'm delighted to welcome two eminent scholars of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community to Faith Matters. Assalamu alaikum, gentlemen. Welcome once again to Faith Matters.
Wa alaikum salam.
It's always a pleasure to welcome both Maulana Abdul Jahangir Khan Sahib, who's head of the French desk. Assalamu alaikum, Jahangir Sahib. And to his right is, of course, Dr. Zaid Khan Sahib, who is the president of the Qaza Board. Welcome once again to Faith Matters. Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Sahib. Today's program, viewers, will focus on Christianity. Specifically, we've got an array of questions across the board, and we'll kick straight off with a question from Noman. Apologies, Noman, you haven't given us your surname, but you've given us a couple of questions, which we'll start off with. And Dr. Sahib, if I could start with you on this one. The first question Noman is focusing in on is regards to the eclipse of the sun and the moon, which is talked about as one of the signs, and it's also talked about in the Bible as well about the coming of the Messiah. And he writes, in regards to the sun and moon eclipse, as well as increased intensity of astronomical activity, and he quotes the particular verse of the Bible, which is Matthew 24, verse 29. He then goes on to say that a Christian friend of his says that he doesn't deny the astronomical data, only their theological interpretation. And he goes on to believe that, in fact, the statement of the eclipses, which are mentioned in the Holy Bible, represents political strife. How do I respond to such a statement? Because Noman writes that, as far as he's concerned, the eclipses occurred, and thus the interpretation of the verse in question has become quite apparent.
Well, I think Noman is discussing a very important subject, the second coming of the Messiah, and the second coming in the latter days, because all religions or religious faiths believe that in the latter days there will be the second coming of the Messiah, who will come to unite mankind and will come to reform mankind and take them back to their Creator. So obviously all religions have set out some signs by which one would recognize as to the time of the coming of the second Messiah, and these are important signs that we must always consider. The thing with religious signs is that when we look at a religious sign mentioned in whichever scripture, Allah, God Almighty, always and sometimes couches these in metaphorical terms, and they should not always be looked at in a literal sense, although they can be literal and specific also to that nature. So as far as the eclipses of the sun and moon that has been prophesied, and as has been mentioned in the Bible, as he has rightly said, we have to look at both parts, whether these are metaphorical, or whether they're literal, or whether they are both, for the understanding of man, so that man should recognize that this is the second coming, this is the time that we should be expecting the second coming. But even if we look at it from a political angle and look at the political changes that take place, then we must admit that the present era, we see the political changes and the rise of nations such as Gog and Magog in that respect, also mentioned by the Holy Quran, and the political fallout in the fallout from these changes also is of a political nature as well. So we do believe that his Christian friend is right in interpreting that the signs can be metaphorical in that sense and not literal. But at the same time, if the signs have been fulfilled in a literal sense, then we must admit that God Almighty has given us to understand the signs from both angles, literal as well as metaphorical. And in this respect, the Holy Quran talks about the eclipses of the sun and moon, and the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam laid a very grand prophecy. And the beauty of this prophecy said that this sign has never been seen before since the creation of the heavens and the earth. And that to me is the actual significance and the importance of that sign to be witnessed. That since the creation of the heavens and earth, that this sign has not been witnessed. Obviously, eclipses of the sun and moon have taken place from the time of creation of the sun and moon. That is not what we are talking about. But the Holy Prophet made a very specific prophecy that the sun and the moon would be eclipsed on these particular dates in the month of Ramadan that had never happened before. And this obviously was fulfilled in 1894, and astrological data is documented to say that it was witnessed on both spheres of the earth, so that the whole of mankind was witness to these signs. So this is the grandest signs of all of the coming of the Messiah that we have witnessed. But at the same time, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left behind for us many other signs to witness as to what would be there for us to recognize that this is the time of the coming of the Messiah. The political changes in the Arab world were talked about by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have seen that they have literally been fulfilled. He has talked about things like changes in the fashion of people, that men and women would begin to dress very similar. We see that in fashion in the West and in the East, that these are signs that we have seen. The sex ratio would change. So the Holy Prophet ﷺ gave many signs. And one thing that I read was from Hazrat Muslim Aud, the second Khalifa of the Jamaat, who actually beautifully makes us understand that when you are looking for a sign, that you should not only concentrate on one sign. And Hazur Raziyallahu Anhu, he said that it is like a good physician. When he is making his diagnosis of an ailment, then he just does not concentrate on one sign or symptom that the patient is suffering from, but he will actually look at all the signs and symptoms and then put them together to form an overall picture and recognize the symptoms of that or the disease from that angle. And that beautifully actually comes into that we must look at all the signs in all aspects, metaphorical and literal, and we will come to understand that this sign has been fulfilled in its complete form for our understanding.
Jazakallah, Doc. So one other element, if I may come back to you on that, he also then refers to a few Christian scholars. He talks about N.T. Wright. In essence, though, when we look at what Mr. Wright has actually written, he quotes Isaiah, and he also talks about the falling of kingdoms and the falling of empires. And equally that the second coming of the Messiah would be a time of great political strife, which you've alluded to. So to encapsulate the sort of answer very much so, it would be true to say then that it's the literal and the metaphorical, as you've said, and put together. If we add them all together, it would then again further endorse the coming of the second Messiah and the acceptance of the Hazrat Promised Messiah, Mirza Ghulam Ahmad.
Absolutely. If we look around the world and look at history and look at the history of empires, then these are certainly true, that the fall of these empires and the transformation of powers is certainly pointing also to the literal fulfillment of the metaphorical nature of the prophecies that were made in the Bible.
Jazakallah, Dr. Saab and Numan Saab, I trust you found your question being answered, but if you've got any other comments, thoughts or observations, indeed, if your friends have any further comments on what they've heard today, please do let us know on faithmatters@mta.tv. We'll move on to our second question, and we're going to travel not far from the UK. We're going to travel to Germany for this question, and it's one of our regular correspondents in this sense, that someone who's written in before. Welcome once again, and a warm assalamu alaikum to Mrs. Ya Kamer Sahi Saiba from Germany. Assalamu alaikum, and thank you for your question. Her question is this, and Jahangir Saab, if I could come to you with this, that she talks of an incident with a Christian missionary who actually came to her house, and she said that all the stories in the Holy Quran are taken from the Bible. Secondly, this missionary also conveyed to her that Jesus is the last prophet because of his atonement for all human beings. So there's no need for any further prophets to actually come. Please could you prove through the Bible that their ideas are not true because they do not believe in the Holy Quran. So this is very much a personal experience of someone coming and talking through the virtues of Christianity, which we fully accept in its pristine form, when Christianity in its essence is very much from the same God and the same principles of religion. But this thing where Christians now deny the acceptance or the need for another prophet because of the concept of atonement.
Well, it does appear to be like a simple little question here, but actually it requires quite extensive answers. Nevertheless, I'll just give a little overview of what it's about. When they say that the Quran has been taken completely from the Bible or from other biblical sources which are not necessarily included in the canon which we have today, or the canons, because there are several, actually, depending on whether you're Catholic or Protestant or Eastern Orthodox, you'd have different numbers of books within your Bible. But they say that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is completely false, that he had come into contact with certain Christian priests or monks, etc., and Jews as well, and so he'd obtained the stories which we have in the Quran from them. Some of them were just oral traditions, and that's why they say this. You know, the stories are slightly different. But actually, what we see is that if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had taken those stories from those sources, then he would have also surely reproduced the errors within them. Mm-hmm. And I mean, there are so many anachronisms, for example, in the Bible, which have not been taken up by the Quran, very strangely, is it not? Because had it been a copy, then not only they would have taken the errors, they would have added on to them as well. Mm-hmm. I'm just going to give one little example here. It is now known that the ruler of Egypt at the time of Joseph, mm-hmm. peace be upon him, was not a pharaoh. He wasn't even an Egyptian. He was of the Hyksos people. And the pharaonic dynasties came after Joseph, quite a while after, almost 100 years after. But in the Bible, we see wherever the ruler of his time is mentioned, the ruler of Egypt, he's called Pharaoh. Okay. And that is, I mean, without giving any quotes, because it's very clear, anyone who wants to read the story of Joseph will find Pharaoh mentioned there. Now, in the Holy Quran, we see that the ruler of Egypt is mentioned in two cases. There's the case of course, Joseph himself, may peace be upon him. But there's also the case of Moses, peace be upon him. And the ruler at his time is mentioned much, much more, often.
Yes. I mean, it's depicted in various programs surahs. And films, and
yes,
which
exactly.
they've made of those times.
That's true. Yeah. But in the Quran itself, it's mentioned much more. In comparison, for example, we find that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the things that happened in his life are mentioned maybe less than that. Mm-hmm. And Moses is mentioned by name many more times than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is, for example. But definitely, he's mentioned more than Joseph is, and the ruler of the time of Joseph, I mean by that. But here is where the Quran draws the line, you know, and doesn't make the mistake that the Bible does. Whenever it mentions the ruler of Egypt at the time of Moses, it always calls him Fir'aun, which means Pharaoh.
Yeah.
And that's historically correct. He was indeed a Pharaoh. And many people have seen his body being paraded around, you know, in different museums, etc., exhibitions and all. But the ruler at the time of Joseph, every time he's mentioned in the Quran, he's called Al-Malik, the king, or the sovereign. So why this differentiation? Where has this knowledge come from for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Because in all the stories of the past, whether they were traditions, oral traditions, or written down in certain books, they would have mentioned that ruler as being a pharaoh, because as long as people could remember, the rulers of Egypt were always pharaohs. So it made sense to them, but actually it's an anachronism. And this is one proof that the Quran, those texts at least, do not come from the biblical sources, because otherwise, as I said, the error would have been reproduced, and they would have added onto it even, possibly. There are many other examples like this, but that was just one. Now, coming to the second question here, which is that Jesus is now, you know, the
because he atoned for mankind.
He's atoned for the whole of mankind, so we don't need any other prophet. Mm-hmm. The question is, what do you need a prophet for? Why do prophets come? Mm-hmm. Prophets actually come for the reformation of people. They come to reform people who are sinning. And they show them the ways to get liberated from sin and to do good and to worship God, etc., to follow God's commandments. That's what the prophets have always been sent for. Mm-hmm. They're always calling to God. Now, had Jesus atoned for the sins of all who believe in his atonement, then we would have seen sin disappearing among his followers. Quite the contrary today, where we find that sin is everywhere, and it's never been, you know, flourishing as much as it has now, arguably, in many respects. And so, obviously, something isn't working with that atonement. But when we look back onto the history of Christianity itself, right up to the beginning, we see that this, if atonement was at all real, then we see such horrendous things which have been committed by Christians, who some of them afterwards repented and became saints, for example, recognized as saints. But however, the atonement didn't stop them from committing those sins. So it's not working. It's not mm-hmm. something which works. But the more basic question which should be asked is that, leaving aside the question of whether atonement works or not, we see it doesn't, but still, did Jesus even die on the cross? Mm-hmm. Because if he didn't die on the cross, then there is no atonement anyway. Mm-hmm. And I'm not going to go into all the details of that, because we've had, you know, whole programs on this very issue. So, as you had said in the beginning, you know, these programs can be now be accessed on YouTube. So, if anyone wants to find out why we say that Jesus didn't die on the cross, they can always do so on YouTube.
Jazakallah, Jahangir Sahib. And just to add to that, though, and I'm sure viewers will see that in some of the subsequent questions we have in this morning's program, will also be, I'm sure, returning to the subject that Jahangir Sahib just mentioned about the death of Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, Hazrat Jesus. But Jazakallah, Jahangir Sahib, and there, sorry, you had one
point. Yes, actually one point.
I'll allow you one
address.
Small addition.
Yes, a very small addition, please. And it is that Jesus himself said that somebody would come after him. That's also a very important point. Because had his atonement been, if he had ever meant to come and atone for the sins, as Christians assert, then he would have never said that somebody needs to come after me. And I'm going to quote John 16 here, verses 12 and 13. It's very short. And this is from the New Living Translation, which seems to be quite popular these days, especially in America. Mm-hmm. And it is that there is so much more I want to tell you, but you can't bear it now. When the Spirit of Truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own, but will tell you what he has heard. He will tell you about the future. And this is exactly regarding somebody coming after him, who is the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, about whom Allah says, وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيُّ يُوحَىٰ. And that's in Surah 53, verses 4 and 5. And it says, nor does he speak out of his own desire. It is nothing but pure revelation that is revealed by God. So whatever he hears from God, he speaks. He is the one who came to tell them all things that Jesus said, you can't bear now. He had so many other things to say, but they couldn't bear them. But somebody else would come after him who would tell them all those things, you see. So there is a need for someone else to come.
Indeed. And just to pick up on that point, perhaps Dr. Syed Saab, if I can bring you in on this as well, that's a very strong point in the sense of the Holy Quran, that the verses of the Holy Quran, which are then quoted, say, in the name of Allah, i.e. in the name of God Almighty. And the other thing, perhaps also, when you reflect on, I recall there's a verse specifically in Deuteronomy as well, which actually talks about the coming forth from the hills of Paran and Faran, which were around the hills of in Saudi Arabia or Arabia at that time, and coming forth with the army of 10,000 people with a fiery law, which was, or a new message. And these are again verses contained within the Bible. But starting first, just briefly with the Holy Quran, it starts, you know, the verses of the Holy Quran start with, in the name of God.
Absolutely. I mean, everything that the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did was in the name of God, the Almighty, the Most Gracious, the Merciful. And the revealed scripture sent to him contains these as the opening verse. And the Bible actually has alluded to that in what Jahangir Sahib has said, that a prophet will come who will speak in the name of God Almighty. And also in the Bible, also in Jeremiah, I don't know the reference net, but there is, Jesus is predicting, prophesying, that a prophet will come who will be the prophet of peace. Mm-hmm. Now this is very significant actually, because obviously all prophets are prophets of peace, and they're not. But according to the Bible, we come back to their scripture to counteract this, is that Jesus was said to be not the prophet of peace, or he did not create peace, but he created division. And this is not us saying it, this is only the Bible that is referencing that. So in that respect, Jesus had prophesied that a prophet who would be a prophet of peace would come, and he would be the one that you should follow. And Islam, as we know, the religion of Islam, the word Islam, the spreading of Salam, of Shusalama, these are all connected with the message of peace. And so therefore, the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was the fulfillment of these prophecies that Jesus had made in the Bible itself that we find. So Christians actually need to study these prophecies in detail and find that it is their own scripture that is pointing to someone that who would come. And Jesus had prophesied it, knowing that a great teacher would follow him and reform mankind.
And this verse from Deuteronomy as well, which talks about the coming forth.
18, isn't it? Where Moses is said to tell the children of Israel that somebody like me, and as God speaking, said, like unto Moses, therefore, will come among your brethren. Mm-hmm. Now, brethren doesn't mean like what to say in the streets these days, my brethren. It's something different.
I'm not quite familiar with that talk, but please do go on.
But it means the brothers of the Israelites. And at that time, there were only one people who could ever qualify to be the brothers of the Israelites. It was the Ishmaelites, because the Israelites descend from Abraham through Isaac, and the Ishmaelites through Ishmael. So they were the brethren people. So he would appear among them. And so he did. And also to add on to what Dr. Sabat said just now, isn't it surprising that here is a religion called peace? Islam means peace. And there is a prophet of Islam, meaning the prophet of peace. So where are they? Why aren't they looking for that person here? These are clear signs which are in their face, so to speak, you know, yet they're not seeing them. But I can't generalize, of course, because many do see these signs and they do become Muslim as well, even some of the clergy. Mm-hmm. Because you see, there are honest, sincere people who are looking for the truth, and when they do find it, they accept it. Allah says about those people that they get a double reward, because they accepted what came before and they accept of what's come after. So they're very lucky people. So we invite others to do the same.
Exactly, the search for truth.
Yes.
Jazakallah, Jahangir Sahib, Dr. Sahib, and Mrs. Ya Kamar Sahib, Jazakumullah, for your question as well. We're going to travel further afield to India next, to Muhammad Hashim Sahib's question. He's got a couple of questions, and Dr. Sahib, before, if I could start with you on this particular question. And this relates to the virgin birth. I'm guessing from his question that he's a Muslim but not of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, because his first question relates to, it is the belief of all Muslims that Hazrat Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, was born miraculously without the intervention of a male, whereas your belief is vice versa. Now, I'm going to stop there. He then goes on to talk about the Quran and Hadith, but there's obviously an error in his mm-hmm. statement that he makes here, because the concept of the virgin birth is something very much that the Ahmadiyya Muslim community subscribes to.
Yes, we cannot speak for other Muslim groups, but we can certainly make it categorically clear to him that Ahmadis, believing in the true essence of Islam, we believe, according to the teachings of the Holy Quran, that Jesus was born without the agency of a father. So that Hazrat Maryam was virgin and she conceived a child in that state, and therefore we categorically believe that Jesus was born without the agency of a father. As we know, we base all our source of guidance, the primary source of guidance has to be the Holy Quran. Regarding this subject also, the Holy Quran is very clear and explicit about the account of Jesus and his birth and his mission and so on. The Holy Quran also actually does go back to the account of Hazrat Maryam. In fact, the Bible is very sketchy on the study of Hazrat Maryam, whereas a whole chapter in the Holy Quran is named after Hazrat Maryam, the mother of Jesus. And when we look at the account of Hazrat Maryam, we then realize the whole scenario of the reason for the birth without the agency of a father, that her mother Hannah had dedicated her unborn child to the ministry. And when the child was born, Hazrat Maryam was born, she was a female, but she was still dedicated to the temple and was of the priestess order in that respect. So that she lived a chaste life and lived a life of celibacy in that respect. And when the, according to the Holy Quran, the angel appeared before Hazrat Maryam, that giving her the tidings that a son will be born to you, she was very much taken aback. And she said that no man has touched me, I am chaste, and therefore how can I have a son? And she was reassured that this is what would happen. Now if you go back into a religious, spiritual sense of that, there is a purpose of Allah behind the birth of a son without the agency of a father, because this signified the transformation of prophethood from the house of Israel to the house of Ishmael. And this was the design of God the Almighty, that the Jews had become morally and spiritually so corrupt and away from their scriptures that there was no one who was worthy of becoming the father of a prophet in the house of Israel, and therefore the agency, the prophethood would be switched to the house of Ishmael, and therefore Jesus was born without the bloodline of the house of Israel. So she received glad tidings, and God reassured her that this is actually the design of Allah, that he can bring about creation of that nature without the agency of the of a father. If you look at it from, if you bring it down to, people like to look at things scientifically nowadays, you know, they question and say, okay, does science actually give substance to this birth without the agency of a father? And without going down too into technical details, we can say that in medical journals, this also has been documented, that there have been instances of girls who have been virgin, have not had contact with a male, have given birth to children. So therefore it is documented, and science is now proving that there are certain conditions within women, that there may be certain tumors in the pelvis region called arenoblastomas, where they actually produce the sperm of a human being, and therefore internal fertilization of the egg can take place in this situation. So scientifically it is a possibility, there is no doubt about that. But when you look at the animal kingdom, we find this even more so common in the animal kingdom. A process known as parthenogenesis is the formation of an embryo without the fertilization taking place. So you have an egg from a female, which will actually develop into an embryo and develop into a living creature without actually fertilization having taken place. And science actually now in laboratory conditions are able to do this through a stimulus of either light or electricity. Mm-hmm. So if these things can take place, then certainly there could always be a possibility that there could be a formation of an embryo inside a woman without the agency of a father. So from the Holy Quran and then explanation from the scientific knowledge that we have today, we can categorically say that this was certainly a possibility. It was a miraculous birth, but not an unnatural birth. And I think this is the way that we should always understand it.
Jazakumullah, Dr. Saab. And Muhammad Hashim Saab, Kerala in India is your hometown, but I hope whatever literature you've come across or you've read is certainly the Ahmadiyya Muslim community's viewpoint as so eloquently described and surmised by Dr. Zaid Khan Sahib on the birth of Hazrat Jesus, peace be upon him. Hashim Saab has another question, and Jahangir Saab, if I could come to you on this, and this relates to the story of Jesus Hazrat Jesus talking from his cradle, and he quotes a translation and commentary of the Holy Quran by Maulana Muhammad Ali Sahib regarding the event when Hazrat Maryam, the wife of Hazrat Jesus, peace be upon him, brings him forth, and it was commanded to her by Allah that when people inquire about the child, that she should point out the infant, which she then does actually talk. So this is about Jesus talking in the cradle. Maulvi Muhammad Ali Sahib's commentary, as quoted by Muhammad Hashim Saab here, says that, and I'm quoting here his question, that comments that since Jesus, peace be upon him, spoke to the people at this situation, the assertion is that he should have been or was a grown-up child or man at this time, and elderly people usually address their young ones as a cradle, which he feels is not right. This is he being Muhammad Hashim Saab, our questioner. Speaking of Hazrat Jesus, peace be upon him, in other places in the Quran, there are authentic hadith in support, which says that only two people spoke in the cradle, of which one is Hazrat Jesus, peace be upon him. Basically, I think Muhammad Hashim Saab is looking for a clarification of what he's read from the commentary from Maulvi Muhammad Ali Sahib and also the Ahmadiyya Muslim community's viewpoint.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe Maulvi Muhammad Ali Sahib wrote that. We're not very sure about that, but he doesn't represent the official standpoint or the view of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community as such. Not necessarily, I mean. The fact of the matter is that we can't reject the hadith or the saying in the Holy Quran either, the verse in the Holy Quran. There were several verses which speak of Jesus, peace be upon him, speaking when he was in the cradle. We do not reject that. We believe that he was speaking at that age. Mm-hmm. Now, one point which needs to be put forward is that the actual fact that he was speaking is not in itself anything, you know, marvelous. There are many small children who can speak at a very small age. Some I've seen myself at the age of one speaking like, you know, they're 10, you know. So it does happen, it does occur. Mm-hmm. And once they get going, as they say, there's no stopping them. But it's why Allah is saying that he actually spoke in the cradle is because he was saying something particular. And it was that he was speaking about holy things, about saintly things, godly things, and that was the point. Because the Jews at the time were thinking that he's an illegitimate child. Mm-hmm. And illegitimate children born in an atmosphere of illegitimacy, they wouldn't be growing up speaking about godly things, usually, because their mothers are not of that type, you know, to teach them that kind of thing. He was saying, as the Quran says, that I am Jesus, son of Mary, and God has made me a prophet. And he was relating his dreams to them. And so little children of that age don't usually speak like that, you see. But we have to also remember, and I'm going to quote a verse from the Holy Quran here. Allah says, this is in Surah 3, verse 47, وَيُكَلِّمُ النَّاسَ فِي الْمَهْدِ وَكَهْلًا وَمِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. And speaking of Jesus, and he will speak to the people in the cradle, and when of middle age, and he shall be of the righteous. And in another verse in Surah 19, which is Surah Maryam, the one that you alluded to a little while earlier, verse 30, فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ قَالُوا كَيْفَ نُكَلِّمُ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الْمَهْدِ صَبِيًّا. So she pointed to him, meaning Mary pointed to Jesus, when they asked her, what have you done? Mm-hmm. You know, where have you been? What have you done all this time, you know? So she just pointed to him, and they said, how can we talk to one who is a child in the cradle? So obviously something did happen of this nature. Okay. But the point is that we need to know what the word Mahd means too. We don't reject the meaning of the fact that the Mahd means the cradle, that means he would have been quite small when he was speaking of godly things like this. It would have been a sign for them that this is a blessed child and you should pay attention to him. But the word Mahd in Arabic comes from a root which means to smoothen things, to prepare things, to prepare the ground for something, for example. And the question we could ask here, did he only speak when he was in the cradle and also when he was of middle age? Kahal in Arabic means the age where your hair starts turning white. It just starts, you know, to turn white. So according to Lane and Aqrab, the two mm-hmm. very well-known lexicons of Arabic, basically the word Kahal means the age from maybe 30 to 51 or 34 to 51, and Thalabi says it's from 40 to 51. So definitely Jesus must have reached at least that age to start, you know, to be mentioned here as Kahlan. Then the word Mahd would cover the whole period from the time he was in the cradle right the way up to all the way up to the when the Kahl period would start
without a break,
because otherwise what would be the point of him speaking there and then speaking again, you know, like 40 years later.
It defines a period, not just an instance.
It also defines a period. Yeah. But as I said, we do not, for as much, you know, say that we don't accept that he spoke in the cradle. He did. He did also speak in the cradle. So basically, we have to accept the two meanings, that one, he did speak when he was very little, but also he continuously spoke, and by speaking it meant godly things, holy things, all the way up to his middle age, which, by the way, also points to the fact that he must have survived the crucifixion period, because that happened prior to when the Kahal period starts. So if he was, for example, around 30, then he wouldn't be, you know, Kahlan yet. Mm. It would have to wait, he'd have to wait for a bit longer, you see. So anyway, that's the answer.
Jazakallah, as far as I can say. Jahangir Khan Sahib and Dr. Sahib. And yes,
by all means. Reference also in Surat Maryam with regards to Hazrat Yahya. Ya Yahya khuzil kitaba wa kuwa wa ataynahu al-hukma sabiyya. So the same word sabiyya has been used in that sense, that we gave him wisdom while he was a child. So prophets of Allah obviously are given wisdom in their younger ages, before actually their hair turns grey, as has mine done. So middle age has crept on me.
Well, I don't know. It's creeping on most of us now anyway. So, but Jazakumullah, Jahangir Sahib, Dr. Sahib, and Muhammad Hashim Sahib, Jazakumullah for your questions. And I hope this has illustrated to you that you are quite right and legitimate in putting forward questions or concerns or observations you've heard about the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. But I hope you will feel, and certainly if you listen to the answers objectively, I'm sure you would agree with me that it's quite clear that quite often sometimes what is put to you as the view of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community is actually wrong, it's erroneous, and actually today you've heard both the standpoint of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community on the virgin birth, which we totally subscribe to, and indeed this of Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, Prophet Jesus talking and having the ability to talk in the cradle, as Jahangir Sahib again has so eloquently put, is also something that the Ahmadiyya Muslim community subscribes to. So I trust that has laid to rest the concerns you have, but if you've got any thoughts, comments, observations, or further questions indeed, Hashim Sahib and others, you know what to do. Please email us on faithmatters@mta.tv. Our next question, gentlemen, comes from Muhammad Irfan Sahib, who extends an assalamu alaikum and a warm assalamu alaikum to the whole panel. He writes that he's heard that Christians are considered as one of the people of the book, Ahl-e Kitab, as it's referred to often. Is this correct? If that is correct, why are they considered people of the book when the New Testament is not regarded as a book from God, Allah Almighty? Dr. Saab, if I could come to you with this.
I think Muhammad Irfan is absolutely correct that the Bible is not a revealed book of God. We do not believe that it is revealed in that sense. It is not a law. Jesus actually did not bring a law. Jesus came and he said, I have not come with a new law, I have come to fulfill the previous law. So in essence, the law that Jesus was following was the law of the Torah, and all people who have believed in Jesus also in that sense follow the religious law of the Torah. So because they follow the law of the Torah, in that sense, in a religious scripture sense, they are followers of the book of Moses, the Torah, and in that sense they are called as people of the book because of the book of Moses. Mm-hmm. Actually, the Holy Quran in Surah Al-An'am, the pagans actually point to this situation. When the Holy Quran was revealed, they said that the revelation of a book has only occurred to two peoples before us, meaning in Arabia, and that was of the Torah, which was revealed to Moses, as they were the people of the book, and they resided in the northern parts of Arabia. And the other people that were sent a book in Arabia were the Zoroastrians, the Zendavesta, which was on the eastern side of Arabia. So this part is mentioned in the Holy Quran, that the Arabia at that time, they were two people who had been sent books, and they were the people of the book. And the Holy Quran obviously is the final law that was sent down by Allah in that respect. So Christians, because of the following of the Torah of Jesus, are considered as people of the book in that respect. Obviously there have been 124,000 prophets that Allah has sent, some with laws, some without laws, some where the book has been preserved in some form or another, and some who still hold on to that book. And because all these prophets of God were from God himself and preached the unity of God, then in their pristine form, the books also contain commandments about the unity of God for their followers to follow in that respect. And there can be other books which God has sent down, which can be considered as the book that of law that is sent down.
So to be, Jazakallah, Dr. Saab, so on this premise, the fact that they are referred, the Christian community is referred to Ahl-e Kitab or of the book, it reverts back very much to them being a denomination or a, you know, progression from Judaism and the law of Torah.
Totally that on two counts, because Jesus himself said that I have not come to break the law, but I have come to fulfill it. So the law that Jesus was following was the law of Torah, and Christians in that respect have also to go back to the law of the Torah in that respect.
And there's an interesting historical perspective here, isn't there, that even at the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in some of his early practices as the Holy Quran was being revealed, when he did revert back, he reverted back to the Mosaic laws.
Absolutely, yes, he respected, because this was a divinely sent law. So therefore there was the law in place at that time, and until God Almighty had revealed anything contrary to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which would deviate from the previous commandments that God Almighty himself had given, he always undertook to give precedence to the law of Moses in all his directives.
Jazakumullah, Dr. Saab. And to our questioner, Muhammad Irfan Saab, I trust you'll agree with me. Your question's been well and truly answered in quite a comprehensive fashion. But if you've got any other further comments or thoughts, please do let us know on faithmatters@mta.tv. Dr. Saab, if I could stay with you for our next question, which comes from Rahan Ahmed Sahib. Jazakumullah. He's from Germany. Assalamu alaikum, Rahan Saab. He writes some very kind comments about Faith Matters and the program and previous programs as well. We're glad you're watching Faith Matters, Rahan Saab, and glad you're also enjoying it as well. He writes that a Christian friend says that they are ensured a place in heaven, referring to the Christian community, since they've accepted Hazrat Jesus as their saviour. How should I respond to this? So by accepting Jesus, we hear this also with Christian missionaries, that you know, you accept Hazrat Jesus, you accept Jesus into your hearts and you shall be atoned. But surely this alludes more to the reforming yourself. It's not just accepting someone which actually makes you a better person. It's actually then accepting them and then trying to emulate what they said and prescribed.
Absolutely. I mean, belief on its own it stands no one in any stead for the judgment that man is going to undertake on the day of judgment. We will be judged by God Almighty according to the deeds that we have undertaken in this life. But the Christian concept of salvation, as Rehan Sab says, is somewhat different, because they think of the concept of atonement and Jesus having atoned their sins, so that is an automatic way of salvation and eternal life for them. But this is actually contrary also to the teachings of Jesus himself, because Jesus did not believe that this was the way to heaven and eternal life. And he has given many directives and guidelines in the Bible, which actually point out the fact that the scriptures, in fact, the salvation, it is said, if you read it in Luke, love God and love your neighbor, and these are paths of salvation. But on another occasion, Jesus was in a gathering, and a man who was an expert on religious law questioned him as to, "Oh teacher, how should we find eternal life?" And Jesus, in fact, pointed him to the law of Moses, and he said, "What do you read in the law of Moses? What does the book tell you?" And the man said, "Love thy God with all thy heart, with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and love your neighbor and yourself." And Jesus said, "Right, this is the path to eternal life." So this is what Jesus was teaching his descendants, that it was a bond with God Almighty, that you must have a bond, an association with your Creator, and then do according to his commandments, and then you will find eternal life. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 21, he says, "By merely following commandments, you cannot earn salvation, only salvation is judged by the purity of our motives." So Jesus is absolutely making it clear that salvation can only be achieved by following the commandments of Allah and following in with the teachings for Christians at that time of what Jesus had taught them, and how to interact with society around them, and how to be better human beings. And these were the paths of salvation, that man would find salvation and an eternal life in heaven afterwards.
Jazakumullah, Dr. Saab. Just as a sort of final point on this as well, I mean, this concept of atonement and acceptance alone, from an Islamic perspective, you know, again, we ask for belief in the revered and supreme of all prophets, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But again, just emphasizing that point, the mere belief and acceptance of a being is not resultant in your atonement. And indeed, this question of being forgiven for your sins through believing alone is not something which is Islamic practice.
Absolutely. I mean, there's an incident of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the most perfect of human beings, the most exalted prophet of all, the last law-bearing prophet. And what do we find as to his attitude to this subject of salvation and finding eternal life? You know, he would stand so much in prayer. We know that his life was perfect with everybody interaction, but his association with God Almighty of forgiveness, he would stand the majority of the night in prayer so that his feet and ankles would become swollen. And his wife, seeing him in this condition, Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha said, "O Prophet of Allah, you are the most perfect of humans. God has chosen you as his own. You are bound to have eternal life in heaven and be with God. So why do you put yourself through all this aggravation?" And he said, "Even I should, one, be thankful to my God, the Almighty, for whatever he has bestowed upon me. And also I should seek his forgiveness in that respect so that I too should find eternal life with God Almighty."
Jazakumullah, Dr. Sahib, a perfect exemplar. Even in his own practices, he always sought forgiveness of God Almighty. Rahan Sahib, Jazakumullah, for your question as well. And do let us know if you've got any thoughts, comments, and in your discussions with your Christian friend, any more questions. Please email them through at faithmatters@mta.tv. Our next question comes from Mr. Og, who writes a question about how things are actually viewed within religion. And he writes in by saying that when we analyze things on Faith Matters, that sometimes they're looked at perhaps in a literal sense. And he says that we try and perhaps put objectivity into understanding spiritual things, and that you have to be truly in the spirit and not literal in understanding concepts. He then writes, goes on to write, that you can never understand the ways of God Almighty. It's a mystery, he says, for he moves in mysterious ways. That's why he suggests that Christianity is a faith. Jahangir Sahib, final question in the program, but an important one, because it's talking about where religion is perhaps, and the critics of religion actually criticize religion because they feel it's more spiritual and mystic in some ways and doesn't have logical explanations. Yet clearly religion, in our understanding as well, there are often very logical explanations which help people understand faith as a concept much better.
Well, this is where some people give in to the atheists, and in particular those who do believe in science, as they should. We can't say that we can ever understand everything that has to do with God, the way he acts or what he does. But that doesn't mean that the religion that he reveals is not logical. It's a very convenient excuse to get oneself out of trouble by saying, well, it's all a mystery, you know, you shouldn't even try to understand it. Because if you try to understand it, the thing is, the problem is, for some certain religions, most of them actually, you could say, and even many interpretations of Islam itself, is that they run into trouble then. Because then they'll start finding contradictions, they'll start finding, you know, illogical things there and irrational things, superstitions even. And that's what they try to hide by saying that's all a mystery. So that's a little bit disingenuous. What God does should not be opposed to the faith. The act of God shouldn't be in opposition to faith at all, you know. And basically this question is trying to have us accept is that there's no need to understand anything about what God does or what God says, what God has taught. There's no need for wisdom. There's no need to use your wisdom to understand these things. Mm-hmm. Whereas the Bible itself actually encourages you to acquire wisdom so that, in effect, you can understand what God is asking of you. So it is important. And then using that wisdom, if you do find illogical things or irrational things, then you should remove them. Mm-hmm. That's the whole point. And I'm going to quote three short verses here from the Bible. First of all, it's in Proverbs 1, verse 7. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. Mm-hmm. So a fool indeed is the one who will despise wisdom and learning. So it's not just about, thinking that everything that God does is mystery. Of course not. Proverbs 13, verse 10 says that through presumption comes nothing but strife, meaning that if you just presume things happen for some reason which you don't understand, that will lead to strife. but with those who receive counsel is wisdom. Mm-hmm. So those who debate of these matters, who thrust them out, who try to understand them, who talk about them with others, they reach to wisdom. And then finally, James 1, verse 5, but if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives all men generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. So the Bible is saying that we need to actively ask for wisdom from God. And what will we do with that wisdom then? Obviously, we'll understand God's commandments all the better. Mm-hmm. So this is very important. So if you see a faith running away from confrontation with atheists on the basis that God is all mystery and we shouldn't try to understand things, you shouldn't think, you shouldn't use your wisdom, mm-hmm. that is just a proof of defeat. Indeed. But by the grace of Allah, the interpretation of Islam, which is made by the Imam Hadi alayhi salam, and which is now continued by his khulafa, his caliphs, in the Jamaat Ahmadiyya, is so logical, so rational, and it gives so much peace of mind, you know, to the person who studies it, that one can only invite the whole world to come and study it and also benefit from that peace of mind that we enjoy.
Jazakumullah. And I mean, that interpretation, Jahangir Sahib, is obviously exactly the way and the methods which the Holy Prophet of Islam deployed in actually conveying the message of Islam in its, when
yes,
it was
exactly.
first revealed.
The way he presented his own religion that he'd brought from Allah was a very logical one. It was devoid of any kind of superstition. There were proofs for everything. The Holy Quran itself is written in such a way that it itself proves every statement it makes and challenges people even very boldly, you know, saying, come forward, that if you think that this is not from Allah, then you produce something like it. There are so many things there which the Holy Quran says and which are you know, proven by the Quran itself, using logic, using rationality. So this is part and parcel of God. He made us rational because we are an image of, you know, of himself. So he also must be rational, and so he is.
Jazakumullah, Jahangir Sahib, for that very clear and concise explanation. And thank you, sir, to your question as well. And I hope it's thrown some light on the Muslim community's standpoint on the interpretation of faith and religion. And I think it would be fair to say that the Ambiya Muslim community's viewpoint's always been not so much to prove other religions wrong, but to establish in people's minds, and more importantly in their hearts as well, the truth of Islam and the fact that Ahmadiyyat is the renaissance of Islam, the same Islam which was revealed to the Holy Prophet of Islam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Gentlemen, we've reached the end of our questions for today. We're on a program which was specific to Christianity. It just remains for me to thank you both for your very eloquent, detailed, and as ever, very detailed answers on array of different questions around Christianity and faith in general. And after all, we are Faith Matters. And to you as well, thank you for the questions you've sent in for today's program. Without you, the program would not be what it is. But just as a final reminder to all of you for future programs, if you wish to have your question read out, and indeed more importantly answered by our scholars on the program, please remember once more the email address is faithmatters@mta.tv. That's faithmatters@mta.tv. And a final reminder, if you wish to hear some answers to previous programs and previous questions that have been posed, just as a final reminder, you can find these on YouTube, MTA Online 1, Faith Matters, and hopefully you'll find the answer just there. For now, from all of us here in London on Faith Matters, until the next time, Assalamu alaikum.